Hello students, welcome again. This is Naren Kumar Devedi starting today's session with topic potential due to a charged spherical conductor, hollow or solid. That may be hollow from inner or solid. So let's start. Suppose we have a sphere of certain radius capital R, and on this sphere of radius R with center O, say we are having positive charges spread on its surface, and due to this let the charges be capital Q. Due to this spreading of uniform distribution of charges on its surface, we need to calculate the potential at certain point. Now there may be, as discussed earlier in electrostatic field intensity calculation, as discussed, that point, test point, might be out of the surface of sphere, maybe on its surface or maybe inside of its surface. So let's discuss those three cases individually. So case number one that we are taking now, when point is at external position, that is when small r, that is the distance of the test point from the sphere, from the center of sphere I must say, is greater than the radius of the sphere. So under that condition, suppose the test point we are taking now here, this is the test point, and the distance from the center of the sphere we say small r. Fine. So under this condition, the sphere behaves as if the charges are concentrated at its center. So directly taking this much distance and those charges at its center, we can write the expression for the electrostatic potential. So the electrostatic potential V is given in this case 1 upon 4 pi epsilon naught charge upon distance. So with this consideration that these charges are concentrated at the center of the sphere, we can directly go for this potential expression. Now case two, when point is on the surface of the sphere, that is capital R is equal to just small r. This point is taken right here. So in that case, small r equal to capital R. So we don't have to do any extra thing here. We just place this or eliminate this small r here in this expression by capital R. So we have 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught capital Q by R. This is actually the value under this condition. Now case number three, when point is in the interior of sphere, that is small r is less than capital R. Under this condition, actually we will be using the result that will be derived just after this topic. So directly we are taking the outcome of that derivation. So here we directly write, since we know that the electric field intensity is negative of potential gradient dV upon dr, and as we know the electrostatic field intensity in the interior of this sphere, charged sphere, is zero. So here we place zero is equal to minus dV upon dr, or else you can write dV equal to zero, and it implies that V equals to constant. So the electrostatic potential in the interior of a charged sphere is just equal to the value of electrostatic potential on its surface. So whatever the potential here on the periphery of this, or on the circumference of this sphere, the same amount of potential will be found at any point in the interior of the sphere. This is the result that we are getting here. Okay, so let's have the variation now. If we just plot the electrostatic potential variation with this distance, so graphically you can write, graphically we can have this, say this is distance small r, and here we have electrostatic potential, and say this is the center of the sphere, and this represents the interior portion, this represents the, on the surface, and this represents exterior of the sphere. So as can be seen, that in the interior the electrostatic potential is just equal to the potential on its surface. So this is this much in the interior, and on the surface the same value. Thereafter it is inversely proportional to r. So we have like this here in the interior, as V is proportional to 1 by r, you can write. Okay students, so let's have next topic, coalescence of charged drops. Suppose we have n number of small drops of radius small r, each having charges small q, and they are now combined to form a bigger drop of radius capital R. So in that case, what is the relation of the charge on bigger drop with the charge on smaller drops? Then how much is the potential, electric field intensity, surface charge density? What are the relation between these? So let's have the discussion on that. So here to start with, actually when n number of drops are mixed to form the bigger drop, in that case the volume of those n number of drops will be just equal to the volume of a single drop, bigger drop. So here we write, since volume of small n drops is just equal to volume of big drop. So here small n is the number, and volume of small single drop 4 by 3 pi small r cube, which is just equals to 4 upon 3 pi capital R cube. So here you can cancel these 3 and just try to obtain the relation of capital R. It's 1 upon 3 taking cubic root on both the sides. So we reach at this relationship with us, small capital R equal to n plus 2 1 by 3 small r. So let's proceed further. Now if we write the charge on big drop, which is equals to let that be capital Q, and if we say one single small drop carries charge small q, and there are n such drops. So under that condition, as we know, the additive property, so the total charge will be the sum of those all n small charges. So n into small q, simply we can have this thing with us. Now, having this and this, we can go for a potential electric field intensity, surface charge density and all. So, let's calculate. Now, potential of bigger drop that is equal to 1 upon 4 pi epsilon naught charge on big drop upon radius of big drop. Now, we have the value of capital Q in terms of small q, we have the value of capital R in terms of small r. So, just placing these values back here, we reach at simply 1 upon 4 pi epsilon naught small n q for capital Q upon n pass to 1 by 3 into small r for this thing capital R. This one for capital R, this one for capital Q. Now just solving it, you will be getting 1 upon 4 pi epsilon naught into small q by small r into in multiple to this n pass to 2 by 3. So try to identify this term. This is actually the potential due to a small drop. So here you can write as n pass to 2 by 3 into potential due to a small drop. So this is the relation between a big drop potential and small drop potential. Okay, so let's proceed further. Now we'll be calculating electric field intensity. So the electric field intensity due to a big drop, electric field intensity, electric field intensity due to electric field intensity on the surface, it would be better to call on the surface of bigger drop. So that we write now E equals to 1 upon 4 pi epsilon naught capital Q upon R square. Now just placing this value and this value back here. So we have now with us 1 upon 4 pi epsilon naught small n q upon this thing n pass to 2 by 3 into small r square. Fine with this? Okay, let's move on. Just have the simplification further. So here you will be having this n pass to 1 by 3 into 1 upon 4 pi epsilon naught q upon this thing r square. So this is actually the electrostatic field intensity on the surface of small drop. So we have n pass to 1 by 3 into electric field intensity on the surface of small drop. Okay, now we can have that surface charge density relation with us. So for that we can have the surface charge density of bigger drop, that is equal to surface charge density is what? Charge upon area. So it's 4 pi capital R square. Now just placing the relation of capital Q and small q and capital R with small r, we have actually here arcs in Q upon 4 pi into this r square was n passed to 2 by 3 into small r square. So simply we can have here n passed to 1 by 3 into Q upon 4 pi r square. So this is surface charge density due to a small norm. So we reach at the final outcome as n passed to 1 by 3 into surface charge density due to a small rod. So this is the last outcome of this topic. Okay students, so let's have next topic with us, relation between potential gradient and electric field strength. As we just before the last topic, we used the result in the third case that electric field strength is negative of potential gradient. So this we must have derivation of that. So let's proceed here. Suppose we have an isolated single charge plus Q placed here at point O, and in the electrostatic field of this, suppose we have two points A and B, namely this is point B and this is point A. Now at point A we will be placing a test charge Q naught in the electrostatic field of that charge, at which the electric field intensity is radially outward along this, and that test charge will be shifted towards point B through dl displacement. And suppose here we have displacement to be vector dl. Now dr we are taking along the direction of this electric field intensity. So now in order to move the test charge placed at point here A to B, we need to apply an external force just equal but opposite in direction to the force given by this electric field intensity to this test charge, that is minus Q naught E. So now to produce this much displacement, what is the amount of work done that will be calculated? So directly we proceed now here. So the amount of work done, we are writing work done which will be equals to force into displacement. So force will be equals to, as I said, Q naught into vector E, and displacement we are producing dl. So as can be seen, electric field intensity is here along positive x-axis and dl is being produced along negative x-axis. So obviously the angle between them is going to be 180 degrees, so that you can have here Q naught E dl cos 180, and cos 180 will give you minus 1, so that minus and this minus becomes plus, and you have Q naught E dl. Now let's write the relation between dl and this dr. So here we write, but as can be seen, dl is just equal but opposite of dr, so we are having this to be dl equals to minus of dr. Just placing this value back here, so we have this work done. Therefore work done has to be equals to it's minus Q naught E into this dr. Now just taking this Q naught here at denominator on cross multiplication, so we write now this to be dw upon this Q naught, which is equals to minus of edr. Fine with this? Okay. As we know, it's basically work done per unit test charge is nothing but what? Potential difference between those two points. So here we write now that term to be dv, and that dv is just equals to minus of edr. Now we can have this at denominator of this on cross multiplying. So this is minus of dv over dr, that is the electric field strength, and this is the relationship between electric field intensity and potential gradient. Okay students, so let's have next topic with us, electric potential due to a dipole at a point on the axial line of dipole. Here actually we will be having a short dipole, and along its axis there will be a test point at certain distance from the mid of the dipole, at which we will be calculating the potential individually due to the negative charge of dipole as well as due to the positive charge of dipole, and later on applying principle of superposition we will be calculating the total potential at that test point, and hence the desired expression will be obtained. So let's proceed here. Suppose here we have a short dipole comprising two charges, namely minus q and plus q, placed at say A and B, and suppose this is the midpoint of it, and from the midpoint on its axis there's, suppose we have a test point P at which the potential has to be calculated. Now the dipole is of half length A, and this is another half length small a. So now let's proceed. As I said, we will be calculating potential due to this at this point, and then potential due to this at this point, and applying principle of superposition we can go for total potential. So let's have potential at P due to plus Q charge, let me call it V1, and this is equals to 1 upon 4 pi epsilon naught charge upon distance. Now what's the distance of this from this test point, or of this test point from the source charge? It's R minus A. So we write now R minus A. Similarly, potential at P due to minus Q charge, we call it left V2, and that's 1 upon 4 pi epsilon naught charge minus Q upon distance of this point, test point from the source charge. So this is R plus A. R plus A. Now we can have total potential using principle of superposition. So potential at P due to dipole is V equals to V1 plus V2. So 1 upon, I must say Q upon 4 pi epsilon naught will be a common term in these two equations which are to be added here. And here you have 1 upon R minus A plus and minus makes minus 1 upon R plus A. So just having the solution of this, Q upon 4 pi epsilon naught, here you will have R square minus A square and R plus A minus R plus A. So here R will get cancelled. 2A, 2QA will make P. So we have finally 1 upon 4 pi epsilon naught P upon R square minus A square as the desired outcome. Now, suppose this test point is taken at far off position in such a way that this distance small r is quite greater than half of length of dipole. So under that condition this term will become r square, neglecting a square as compared to this r, we have, if r is much much greater than a, then v equals to 1 upon 4 pi epsilon naught p upon r square. So this is the outcome. Okay students, so let's have the last topic of today. It's electric potential due to a dipole at a point on the equatorial line. Perpendicular bisector position of short dipole, there will be a test point at which individually potential due to minus Q and plus Q charge of dipole will be calculated. Later on, applying the principle of superposition, the total electric potential due to that short dipole will be calculated. So let's proceed. Suppose this is minus Q charge, this is plus Q charge, point A, point B, and suppose this is mid of it. From the mid of this, there is a test point P at distance small r, short distance, half length of dipole AA, line joining the minus Q charge of test point and line joining the plus Q charge of test point. Now, the potential at P due to minus Q charge, we can write V1 equals to 1 upon 4 pi epsilon naught charge upon distance, that's AP, and the potential at P due to plus Q charge V2 equals to 1 upon 4 pi epsilon naught plus Q upon VP. Now the potential at P due to the dipole V equals to V1 plus V2, and here Q upon 4 pi epsilon naught will be a common term, and we have minus of 1 upon AP plus 1 upon BP. Now as can be seen, this distance and this distance will be just equal. So for that reason, here we write, since AP is equal to BP, so we have the potential to be equal to 0. So this way students, remember, at the perpendicular bisector equatorial position, at any point on the equatorial position or perpendicular bisector of dipole, the electric potential due to this dipole will always be 0. Okay students, so this is the end up of today's session. Do like and subscribe this channel.